Well, good morning, everybody. Summer is here. Yes, we're 3 days in, and summer's already taken a break. But it is so good, the cameo appearance that he decided to make. So it's good to see everybody. And before we get into this, I just want to ask the Lord to be with me, that he would allow his word to speak with great clarity, that there would not be any distractions to his word. And that we will leave here challenged and encouraged. So if you would, just bow your heads with me as I go to the Lord in prayer. Father, thank you so much for your word today, and thank you so much for the reality that without it, we're nothing. We need you, and we need a word from you today. And I pray, Lord, that you would go before me, that you would order not only my tongue, but my steps, to be consistent, that there would be no gap between what I'm saying and what I'm living. And God, I pray that you would give us a great encouragement, that you would be tender in your mercy with us as we engage your word. I pray that it would be less of me and more of you. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, this last week I had an opportunity. I was on the board of MOPS International, Mothers of Preschoolers, and I know many of you probably thought that's an exact thing that you were wondering where that I was a part of, but it was an amazing week just to serve the Lord and be with them in Denver, Colorado. And if you've never had an opportunity to go to Denver, I don't know if the Lord lives there, but he certainly has made his imprint on the surroundings. It is an amazing place to wake up in the morning and look and see the mountains. And I had a chance to spend some time with my baby brother that's there. He's single, ladies, so just wanted to throw that out there. But it was just great to be able to be with him and just be able to share with him. And as I was reflecting on the word today and looking at it each night, we're in Hebrews chapter 11. So let me invite you to grab your Bibles, look on with your neighbor. There may be a Bible nearby you. I would like everyone under the sound of my voice to see these words so that you know that they're not my words, they're the words of the Lord. And we're going to read those three verses. But before we get into that, I want to give you a little background, a little context of what we're looking at. We're kicking off our summer series called Unsung. We're looking at ordinary people who had extraordinary faith. And as we look at God's word and we look at faith, I think that there's a lot of confusion, quite frankly, about what faith is and what faith isn't. And my objective today is to raise your faith, to clarify what faith actually is, and then to share with you just a little bit, just a small snippet of the power of God. The title today that we're looking at is The Impact of Persevering Faith. The Impact of Persevering Faith. You need to know a few things about Hebrews if you're going to understand the fact that we're jumping in chapter 11. The people and the writer, if you will, of Hebrews, there's a lot of really debate. We don't know who the writer of Hebrews is. But it's a letter that really is a sermon that's written to the church there. And the reality is this: they were facing great persecution and great challenge. And one of the things that the writer was doing was exhorting them to raise their faith and to stand strong in the Lord in the midst of persecution. That we need to persevere in our faith. Sounds like something that we could all relate to today, amen? I mean, maybe we're not being thrown in jail. And maybe you haven't been persecuted for your belief in Jesus Christ. But as I talk with many of you understand at least a little bit of what it means to actually go through and to be, if you will, tempted, to go through challenges, to go through trials in your lives. And quite frankly, many of you know what it means to almost lose faith. So as we look at the scriptures, we probably should ask the question, what does it mean to persevere? And I love the definition of perseverance, to continue on a course of action even in the face of difficulty or with little or no prospect of success. Let me read that again, because you need to grasp what that definition is. To continue on a course of action even in the face of difficulty or with little or no prospect of success. Hebrews 10:34 is a very important verse for us in context to understand. And all of us pastors, as we were talking about this, it brought to mind Dr. Michael Van Lanningham shared with us John Piper's treatment of this text. And he went to Hebrews 10:34, which is before our text today. And I want to read it because it helps you understand why these people were thought of so highly and why perseverance is at the center of our conversation today. It says, "For you had compassion on those in prison, and you joyfully accepted the plundering of your property, since you knew that you yourselves had a better possession and an abiding one. You had compassion on those in prison. You joyfully accepted the plundering of your personal property, since you knew yourselves that you had a better possession and an abiding one." It's interesting, as we think about having perseverance, I haven't recently given joy and thanksgiving for my personal property being plundered. Have you? "Hey, honey, my car got stolen. I got carjacked last night. Praise be to God. He is the righteous one. That someone actually broke into our house and took our goods." Well, we just give God thanks for that. "Someone in our church was thrown in jail for their beliefs, beaten, almost left for dead. And we went to go visit them, and we gave God praise and thanksgiving because he persevered." That's exactly what they were being commended for. But there were others who were being challenged and even walked away from the faith. Pastor Greg Groeschel says it this way: "If we're not ready to face opposition for our obedience to God, then we're not ready to be used of God." If you're not ready to actually go through something, then you're not really ready to be able to stand for something. My dad always used to say to me, "Son, you need to learn to stand for something or you'll fall for anything." That is never more true today than not standing on God's word. You have no defense against sin or the wiles of the enemy. So what exactly is faith? If we're going to talk about it, we probably should talk about what it's not. Faith is not a force or a power. You know, it's just this force or power that I feel. That's not what faith is. Faith is also not a tool to get from God what you want. I've heard this passage preached many times incorrectly, where people actually use it as a tool to try to get God to do what we want him to do. You know, I've been praying, I've been fasting, and I've been spending time with the Lord, and clearly God wants me to have this house. We even went and laid hands on it. We just know that this is what God has for us. This condo is mine, thus saith the Lord. And I just have faith that that's what it's going to be. Don't raise your hands, but some of you probably have done that before, haven't you? Sorry, that does not mean faith. In fact, that's not faith at all. That's presumptuousness. What faith is something much, much deeper than that. Faith is also not magic. Faith is not magic that we just sprinkle some pixie dust on a situation and it's going to change. And faith is not a formula. It's not A plus B equals C. That's not how faith works. It never has and it never will. It's not a formula. Pastor Andy Stanley says, "Faith is the confidence God is and will do what he promised to do." That's the simple definition. The faith that God is and God will be who he promised to be. That's what faith is. And so we go to our scripture today, and let's look at the words that the writer shares with what faith is. Now, faith is the assurance of things hoped for, the conviction of things not seen. For by it, the people of old received their commendation. By faith, we understand that the universe was created by the word of God, so that what is seen was not made out of things that are visible. May the Lord have a blessing to the reading of his holy word. Let's walk through this verse by verse, and let's look and see what God has for all of us today. The first thing is persevering faith anticipates God's blessing. Persevering faith anticipates God's blessing. The scripture says faith is the assurance of things hoped for. The phrase by faith in chapter 11, it appears 19 times. If something appears 19 times, we probably should look a little close to it, don't you think? That by faith is a very important phrase that we have here in chapter 11. And in fact, some of your translations may read, faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. Some of your translations read that way. There's this connection with the word in the Greek of assurance. It's really a hard word, honestly, to interpret. People have been battling this for quite some time of looking at what does this really mean? What does it mean that we have assurance and we have hope? Think of it as assurance and hope are neighbors. They live in the same neighborhood together. That the assurance that we have is not something that we are not sure of. It is something that we know. We know it factually to be true by evidence. And it's because we know it to be true by evidence that we actually have hope in what it is that we're looking at. Another way to explain it in practical terms is I walk in to my job and I hope to get a promotion from my boss. And I'm hoping that the conversation will go well. And before I open my mouth, my boss says, hey, Ed, we've been thinking about you, and we'd like to actually offer you this position, this increase of pay, and this additional vacation. Well, first of all, we'd just be shouting right there in the office, amen? But at that moment, the faith or the assurance is based on not a hope anymore. It's based on what I factually know. It has happened. And I'm going to go home and I'm going to tell Marcia, honey, this is what's been presented to me. And I think this is what we'd like to do. And I'm acting now off of faith of something that's already been done. It's important for us to understand that in the context of this, because once confirmed, my hope moves to faith. Why is that important, Ed? It's because faith is now the reality of the future blessings that constitute, if you will, the objective of my hope. I love the theologian Dillich. He put it this way. The proper object of hope is the future, and the proper object of faith is the present but unseen. Have you ever wondered how two people can look at the same thing and not see what it is? Can look at the same situation but come to completely different results. I thought I'd illustrate this a little bit and play a game with you. Some of you have already probably seen this, but I want to play a game with you this morning in church. Isn't it great to play games in church? I got in trouble a lot as a child doing that. That's another sermon. But on the screen, there's a picture of a beautiful young woman. I want you to just look at that real quick. How many of you see the young woman by a show of hands? Okay? cathedral is awake today. How many of you honestly say, Ed, I can't see her. I don't know where she's at. Yeah. Okay. How many of you see the old woman? A few less hands. Everybody's like, oh, I don't know. How many of you don't see the old woman? Awesome. I'll put it on social media so you guys can see it later. You can study it for about 5 hours. The old woman, if you look at the picture, if you look to the far left, you see her chin. Now do you see it? Yeah. 13 more people said yes. You all are looking at the same thing, but coming to different results. But I didn't want to stop there. I wanted to have a little bit more fun. Anybody see the bunny rabbit? Can you see the bunny rabbit? Yeah. That's the easy part. Anybody see the duck? Everybody's like, yes, yes. You're all looking at the same thing, but you're coming to different results. I see this every day in my life in ministry, where people see the same thing, but they come to vastly different results. Faith is the conviction of things not seen. You guys saw that. But faith is the conviction, even if you don't see it, you know that it's true. Persevering faith 2.2 receives God's approval. Persevering faith receives God's approval. As we leave verse 1, that verse conviction is seen only once in the New Testament. But in the Old Testament, the few times that is mentioned, it is almost always listed as proof or evidence of something. And so verse 2, we get into it. It says, for it, the people of ancient or the people of old received their commendation. I love this verse. The people of old. Who are the people of old? It's not talking about old people in the congregation. Thank you. I'm 47, and I'm getting older, and I love it. But it's not talking about me. And it's not talking about senior citizens. It's talking about the people who are going to be listed in chapter 11, who are the saints of old who lived by faith. It's interesting to me, as you look at the people who are listed in chapter 11, they understood something about chapter 11 before it was ever written. They understood verse 6 in chapter 11. That without faith, it's impossible for us to please God. I didn't say that. The writer of Hebrews said it under the inspiration of the Lord. It's impossible, my friends, for you to please God without faith. What's amazing about the people that are listed, the heroes and the sheroes that are listed in chapter 11, what's awesome about it is that none of them saw the promise. Not one of them saw the promise of the Savior. You and I have the benefit, the unbelievable benefit, of knowing the history of what God has done. We know that the resurrection took place because of evidence that has been found in documents that have been written. But the people who are here in this chapter, none of them had the opportunity to see the promise. The word for commendation is used 7 times in Hebrews, and it always refers to the witness of biblical record, that these characters received the praise of Scripture and thus of God who inspired it. How would you like to live a life that God brags on you? That's what's happening here in chapter 11. Hey, by the way, by faith, and insert your name. By faith, Caroline did this at Google. By faith, Elvin did this as he was working and doing his job. By faith, Marcia did this as she was serving her family and loving the community. By faith, we get a chance to be God's bragging. I just am blown away when I look at Job chapter 1. In your free time, you should look at Job and read how it starts. We always talk about the hardship that Job went through, and trust me, he persevered and he did. But chapter 1 begins with a conversation of Satan with God, where Satan's just rolling the earth looking for someone to try to devour. And God says, excuse me, bruh, have you looked at my servant Job? He's available. Look at Job chapter 1. That's exactly what happened. He looked at it and said, have you considered my servant Job? If Job was eavesdropping on that conversation, what do y'all think he would have said? Excuse me, God. Excuse me. Getting a little too full of yourself. Oh, my bad. You can do that yourself. You're God. I believe that Job would have been very concerned. What's in it? God clarifies. You can do anything that you want to him. Just don't kill him. So that means I could touch his wife and family? Yep. All of his possessions? Yes. Can I do anything that I want to do? Yes. Do whatever you want, because I believe that what's inside of Job is going to come out, and he's going to persevere by faith. It's like me being on the golf course with my friend Michael, and I hit a good shot. And he looks at me and he says, Ed, I told you, it's in there. We don't know about the other 12 shots that you shot, but that one, we know for a fact that it's in there, that faith is in you. Hebrews 11:12 puts it this way. Just look down a few verses, because I want you to see this. These all died in faith, not having received the things promised, but having seen them and greeted them from afar, and having acknowledged that they were strangers and exiles on earth. That is the prize. They died not knowing, and they still had faith. What about you? Are you willing to die not seeing what's promised, but having faith? Which leads us to point 3. Persevering faith knows God's power. Persevering faith knows God's power. I love that the passage moves from a definition to an illustration. For all my college students that are here today who've sat in biology class and been made fun of, for all of the people who are here who have wondered oftentimes about creation and what actually happened, for all of those who were told that evolution is actually factual, this is the verse for you. It isn't just dropped by accident, but listen to the science that's dropped on all of us in verse 3. By faith, we understand that the universe was created by the word of God, so that what is seen was not made out of things that are visible. I'm going to expound on this a little bit more, but let me just read it again, because it's so crystal clear for you and I to listen to what God and the authority of God's word says. That by faith we understand that the universe was created by the word of God, so that what is seen was not made out of things that are visible. How do you know that the world was made by the word of God? Well, thank you. I'm glad you asked. Let's look at another scripture just real briefly. Look at Psalm 33, verse 6 through 9. Just run with me quickly to Psalm 33, verse 6 through 9. God's voice spoke the universe into existence. And I think one of the things that is challenging for us in faith is not whether or not something is factual. It's for us asking the question, is it reasonable? Is it even plausible that that happened? Listen to the word of God in Psalm 33. And I'm going to start at the sixth verse, go down to the ninth verse. By the word of God, the heavens were made, and by the breath of his mouth, all their hosts. He gathers the waters of the sea as a heap. He puts the deep in storehouses. Just think of that phrase. He puts the deeps of the ocean in storehouses. Let all the earth fear the Lord. Let all the inhabitants of the world stand in awe of him, for what? He spoke, and it came to be. He commanded, and it stood firm. I've often heard people say, you know, Ed, seeing is believing. Any of you ever heard that? Seeing is believing. Actually, for us today, not seeing is believing. And it's not seeing based on evidence, not theory. So I went a little further with this. So for you all that don't like to geek out, y'all just sit with the rest of us for a moment, because we're going to have a geek out moment where we look at God and we look at his greatness. We look at his awesomeness. My mind was blown and I had to close the Bible because I couldn't take thinking about what I was looking at. It was evidence that I was looking at, and I could not even bear to and contain the reality of it. And I was thinking about and looking at the sun. I know in Chicago, it's a guest that shows up periodically in our lives. But I was thinking about the universe, and I was thinking about that the universe has order. There's complexity. The universe speaks to a creator, some made being, something created this. And so if you're here under the sound of my voice and you don't know the Lord as your Savior, or maybe you're a scientist and you are grappling with the statements of the last 3 minutes, I just want to say thank you for leaning in. But I want to challenge the thought that this is some combustion or chaos that just happened and brought the world and the universes into being. The sun, as I was researching, is our nearest star. And it's 93 million miles from the earth. Just let that sit in for a moment. 93 million miles away is the sun. And the sun, you didn't ask it to come up this morning. It came up and it goes down. And it's actually rather timely how it does it. It's amazing what depends on the sun. All of life and all of creation depends on the energy that we get from the sun. The core of the sun is 27 million degrees. Of course, I asked the question, how did they know what the core of the earth was? And that's a longer discussion for another day. But 27 million degrees is how much the core of the sun and what it gives off. The sun gives off more energy in 1 second than all of mankind since Adam and Eve to now. Let me say that again in case you missed it. The sun gives off more energy in 1 second than all of human history since Adam and Eve. Is your head exploding yet? But it gets even better than that. The earth is actually not the largest star. In fact, it's one of the smallest stars. So I went a little further and just said, I'm really starting to geek out. Now, let me look at the universe and the galaxy and the stars that we have. Well, far as we know, we have over 100 million stars. And when you get past our galaxy, there are over 100, let me get it right, billion galaxies. 100 billion galaxies. If your mind hasn't exploded yet, let me share with you a 2-minute clip of the awesomeness of God as it pertains to the sun. And I'll be back to close.
To gain perspective with the aid of computer animation, let's now travel with the Earth to the sun at 100 times the speed of light. From this view, we begin to appreciate the magnitude of our home star. Over 1 million Earths would fit inside the sun. Yet our sun is an average-sized star. Many stars in our own galaxy dwarf it. Arcturus is the fourth brightest star in the night sky. Though 200 trillion miles away, this orange giant is visible to the naked eye. By moving our sun next to Arcturus, we can grasp its immensity. Arcturus is 100 times brighter, with a radius 20 times greater than the sun's. Yet even Arcturus appears small when compared with the supergiant Betelgeuse. Betelgeuse has a radius 600 times that of our sun. A reddish star, it shines a remarkable 60,000 times brighter than the sun. However, even Betelgeuse is not the largest star in our galaxy. Several red supergiants in the Milky Way are even larger, some with a radius 1,500 times that of our sun.
Well, one of the things in creation that I think really exhibits God's power is the power released in stars. The sun, it releases more energy in 1 second than a billion major cities on the Earth, if there were a billion, would produce in a year. And that's just released in 1 second. You can imagine that. Of course, there are stars that are even more powerful than the sun. And just imagine all that power, all those stars, billions of stars in our own galaxy, billions of stars in other galaxies. And yet the Bible describes the creation of all that energy, all that power with the single phrase, He made the stars also.
When we consider that these ratios present only a sliver of our Creator's power, certainly we can agree with the psalmist when he exhorts, "Let all the earth fear the Lord." Of course, the stars reveal more than raw power. Without the light of the sun, all life on earth would soon perish. The sun's life-giving energy provides a constant reminder of our Creator's steadfast love, the God who shines His gift of light on all.
Is your head tired? That God, and we were talking about one star. Why is this important for us? Why are we spending so much time talking about faith? It's because there are hundreds of thousands of people just like you who are leaving church every year. You know why they're leaving? Because they have a mixed up view of what faith is. Pastor Ed, I've been praying for a spouse and I have faith that God's going to give me a spouse, and He didn't, and I'm mad at Him. I'm going to leave. I prayed, and we all prayed, for Ed's mom to live, and she didn't, and she died. And so now I hate God because He didn't give me what I deserved. My mom did pass away. Maybe you're sitting here and you have expectations on God for things in your life, and you're mad at him because he hasn't showed up. Well, newsflash, and it's a little harsh, that's not faith. And he didn't promise you any of those things. In fact, he did promise you this, that in this world, you will have problems. But greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. But he did leave us with one promise. And this is the promise that all those people believed, and they died believing. And this is how we're going to close it today. I want you to look at Romans 5:8 with me. Romans 5, verse 8. And because it's so good, I'm going to start at verse 6. For while we were still weak, at the right time, Christ died for the ungodly. For one will scarcely die for a righteous person, though perhaps for a good person, one would dare to die. But here it is. Here's the promise. But God shows his love for us that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Y'all should just be tearing the roof off this place on the fact that while you were a sinner, Christ died. That's the promise that he gave us. That is the faith that we have. I have faith in the fact that Christ died. I have faith that he got up. I have faith that that immense God that we just gave you a piece of created this universe, and he can handle your problem. He can handle your desire. He can handle the tension and the crisis of faith. So for the next 10 weeks, we're going to be looking at people who showed extraordinary faith, and I cannot wait to open up the scriptures along with Pastor Jeff and Pastor Dave Stone for each and every one of you. So let's pray. Father, thank you so much for the unbelievable faith that was shown in this passage. God, we thank you so much for your goodness, and we thank you for the fact that even while we were late to our own salvation, that you died for us. And so, God, in our absence of faith, would you raise our faith? Would you help us to believe what you already have claimed is true? That there is no one like you. And it's because of that we stand together now as we worship in response to you, the faith that you've made possible and open to all of us in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's stand and respond in worship to the Lord.